Welcome to Rebuild My Church Again, RMCA Bishop Channel. May God bless you for subscribing this channel and reward you for your goodwill to listen to this spiritual talk on radical solution for spread of corona. Today you can be very happy that God has chosen you from among many for hearing this talk. Surrender all your problems and worries, difficulties and anxieties at the foot of the cross. As you listen this talk prayerfully and attentively, I am sure God will shower His mercy upon you and on your family. We are going through a difficult phase of life in India, something like the Spanish flu that happened in 1918. There is fear gripping slowly everywhere. What does the Lord want us to do in such a scenario? This is what I would like to reflect with you today. In this reflection, what I would like to emphasize is on self-responsibility. With regard to COVID-19, it is clear that the virus comes from outside our body. It is not generated inside. This virus is only a visitor. But once it gets in the body, it does its work, which is dangerous for it. A dog will bark and a snake will bite because it is its nature. Similarly, the coronavirus will attack. Let us have no doubts about it. Therefore, each one has to take the responsibility for oneself that it does not get into the body. There is no one whom we can blame for it if it happens. So, shut down the doors and windows of the body, then virus cannot enter. So, my dear friend, let me repeat, there is no point in blaming a second person if you are tested positive. Being tested positive may not necessarily cause your death, but you stand definitely in danger of it. If this is understood by all, we already won half the battle against corona. Number two, self-responsibility demands taking precautions. As a layman in the medical field, I do not know what are the precautionary measures that I should take to prevent the virus. It is the duty of the state to give awareness about it to its citizens. I think from that point of view, the state has done a remarkable job. They continuously give protocols or instructions to the citizens from time to time according to the daily reports coming from the field. They indicate their seriousness by placing the police personnel in public places to check whether all follow the protocol. Recently, I witnessed a scene on the road where a lady was while traveling in the car was found attacking a police personnel for requesting her to wear mask while traveling in the car with her husband. The police were extra decent in this case and they tried to make her understand the protocol even if they are in private vehicle and pleaded her not to create unnecessary scene on the road as they had many other hazards to cross while doing the corona duty, including risking their own lives. Unfortunately, they could control the situation only after arresting them for disturbing the public order, impeding the police in exercise of their duty, etc. The point is, one should not expect others to take medicine to prevent diarrhea for oneself. Similarly, one cannot expect others to take precautions to stop the coronavirus and entering into one's body. This is what we call self-responsibility. And small children are exempt from this. Those who are capable of self-responsibility in other matters should be held accountable in this matter also. Refusing to take precautions is like committing suicide, and if so, it is a crime. We are living in a world of information and communication. There is enough credible information available to the citizens. In pandemic situations, one should be humble enough to go out of the way and gather the required and sufficient information on the matter, especially from all authorized sources. The third aspect is one is duty bound not to distribute it to others. In spite of all the efforts by the government, if the citizens are not cooperating, then why not hold responsible and accountable someone from whom the COVID-19 has spread to the other? For example, how will it be if a provision is made in the law to give a complaint by a COVID patient against another person whom he doubts as the source person? Acting on the complaint, the accused can be made to undergo a medical test to see whether he is a carrier and that he had not taken precautionary measures and flouted all the protocols even when there were no symptoms. If found guilty, he can be given token punishments like confining him in government quarantine for longer periods, doubling of his electricity bill for a certain period, etc. This would encourage and force all to take precautions to avoid being accused of violating the protocols and of being unnecessarily a carrier of the virus. This law will do the trick in breaking the chain of spreading the virus in no time. If a law is made, then we don't need police on the road to monitor the protocol, risking their lives too in the process. Let the people go anywhere, let them be free, but if accused, let them pay for it according to the provisions of the law. This type of fixing responsibility will be an option that the state can think of in order to break the chain instead of nationwide lockdown, which may break the financial backbone of the country. This law should be enforced only during the pandemic, and the rampant abuse of the law should also be prevented as it is happening in POXO and other cases. The next aspect of dealing with the virus is about the responsibility of others towards COVID patients. Here, of course, come the questions about supplying COVID patients all what they require since they are restricted in space, be it food, equipment, hospitalization, ICU beds, oxygen, ventilators, medicines, etc. Here, the government has a big role to play. If the government is not prepared sufficiently for a particular emergency, it is natural for them and also are duty bound to seek the help from other stakeholders like its own citizens, voluntary agencies and organizations, etc. In short, it is the responsibility of the state to mobilize necessary and timely help for the safety of its citizens. If there are omissions from the part of the state, instead of celebrating it in the press, it should be brought to the attention of the people concerned, because this is not the time to blame anybody, but rather cooperate with the state in all possible ways in favor of suffering citizens who have a right for medical and other care. An emergency situation should be considered as a priority. This is not the time to teach others lessons. This is not the time for hit him when he is down strategy. That is simply sadism. This must be avoided at any cost. If anyone is found indulging in deliberate, unreasonable, third-rate negative criticism of all what the government is doing on the pandemic or on the selfless works of other voluntary agencies, strict action should be taken against them. The saddest note in this reflection is about black market and profiteering. We do understand the market economy. The price of a thing is determined on the basis of demand and supply. But this cannot be the formula during any pandemic. I heard an injection which was once available for just Rs 4,500 is now costing 45,000 in one town, and in another town they are asking for the same drug a huge sum of Rs 7 lakhs. These are not exaggerations. The same goes with the price of the oxygen and many other things related to it. Exploiting the situation, especially in an emergency scenario, is a crime. It is an open corruption. Therefore, such things should be brought to the notice of authorities immediately. Then only it can be stopped. Otherwise, as a consequence, all COVID-19 patients will end up as victims of the pandemic. The last consideration is about the volunteers and health workers. We always witness hundreds and thousands of volunteers coming out when there is an emergency like a flood, earthquake, fire, etc. But that kind of a response cannot be expected during a pandemic, because here there is a real threat to the life of the volunteers. In one Catholic diocese in India, they had made a COVID-19 funeral team. Later, two of them were hospitalized for testing positive. This is to underline the risk factor for those who deal with the COVID-19 cases, be it doctors, nurses, other hospital staff, volunteers, the police personnel, etc. In one of the hospitals in North India, where when they did not have the staff ready to load the dead bodies into the vehicle and carrying them for cremation, the nuns of the convent staying in the same campus had to come forward to do that. These are not the normal works expected from our consecrated nuns done in their ministry. This is to show that the risk factor is very much frightening for some, at least, who are in the medical and other caretaking field. I do appreciate and thank the nuns who are giving these types of services in various parts of India. But then ordinarily, we cannot consider the nuns as substitutes for the frightened staff of the hospital, even if they volunteer to do that. At the same time, we should not ignore this legitimate fear of the hospital staff dealing with the COVID-19 patients and unnecessarily blame them for failing in their duty. So what is required is to encourage and support them instead of demoralizing them. Even if one is not generous enough to uphold them, please don't discredit and demolish them. In conclusion, all should remember this: not getting affected by COVID-19 is the best charity you can do to our health sector. Not getting affected by COVID-19 is the best sign of real patriotism. Not getting affected by COVID-19 is the best tribute you can offer to humanity. Let us offer all COVID patients to God and pray with the St. Paul, as in 2 Corinthians 1, 3-4. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulation. So my friend, when troubled and in need of comfort, always turn to Jesus. And as written in 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 11 to 12, then you will be of good comfort. Be of one mind, live in peace, and the God of love and peace will be with you. Now, my dear friend, share this message with your near and dear ones, to please, by doing these types of small good acts. I pray that God gives you love and peace, success and prosperity in everything and everywhere. May Almighty God bless you. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. A few hours from now, listen one more talk and it will bring you more God's blessings. Wish you all good things in life. Yours in the mission of the Church, Bishop Franco Mulakil.